I believe that which I'm going to share with you is the biblical viewpoint, and I'm going to build my case, and I'm going to give you some answers, and I'll give you some arguments why I say so. But at the end of the seminar, once you've heard everything, once you've seen everything, it's up to you to make up your mind, and it's up to you to sort things out with God, and to base your case on the Bible, because this is what it's all about. It's the Bible and homosexuality. I use a term which I have put together, a term that's also used by Professor Robert Gagnon of America, homosex. It's simply a term that helps us to understand when we speak about sexual relations that we're talking about sexual relations of people of the same gender. So that is then something that we need to take cognizance of right from the beginning, because I use the term. And I see that the newspapers have picked up the term as well. The day before yesterday, I saw that Gerrit Brandt was writing in the Burger, and he used the term homosex as well. So it's a term that tries to put across a specific content. But there are many terms, and we should be careful when we use words, because words carry meaning. Before we start, let's just pray together. Lord, we thank you for this time that we can be together this morning, and we ask that by your grace you would be in our midst, that you would guide us in everything, because it's not about downgrading people, it's not about breaking people down, but it's trying to find answers from your word, trying to understand your will for mankind. And when we do this, we do it hesitantly, because we are so dependent on you. And we ask, Lord, that by your grace, grant us the wisdom, the insight, the understanding to discern your perfect will. Amen. Within this presentation, there will be a few sections where you just follow what is happening on the screen, that I don't have to talk for 4 or 5 hours continuously. So you follow what happens on the screen, and try to read what is said there as quick as possible. Mostly the screen will be up for 10 seconds or sometimes 15 seconds. We will then start with the presentation. Few things that I would like to state beforehand, so that you know what I believe, where I come from when we talk this morning. I don't hate homosexual people. When I bring a particular viewpoint to you this morning, and when I speak out against homosexual conduct, then it's not because I hate homosexual people. I have been cited for hate speech because of these lectures. But I want to assure you there's no hate in my heart when we talk about this topic. I counsel many gay people and many lesbian people that comes from counseling, that we try to help and assist with their problems. So we help where we can. I do not agree with gay theology. I believe it's false to be exposed and to be resisted. Gay theology is a theology that changes the theology that I believe is the correct theology based on Scripture. So I do not agree with gay theology, and that I would like to expose as far as I possibly can. I believe that gays and lesbians should be welcomed into the church. The church can't close its doors to people, so they need to be welcomed into the church. They need to become part of the community, of the community of believers. So that is to be made clear as well. But I believe that the Bible, and therefore also God, regard homosex as sin. That's my point of departure. And based on the Bible, I clearly believe that to be the case. Teaching that homosex is intrinsically sinful is not hate speech, but an act of love based on the gospel. So those are my points of departure. It gives you a little bit of background before I start this lecture, what it is all about. Now, what is the purpose of this seminar? The purpose of this seminar is simply to show that God regards homosex to be intrinsically sinful and not a normal variant of sexuality. There is the assumption today that sexuality is a broad band on a linear scale, if you want. On the one side, it's heterosexuality. On the other side, total homosexuality. In the middle, it's bisexuality with all the variants then in between there. But I believe that that's a false presentation based on the Bible, that homosexual conduct is not a normal variant of sexuality, and thus that the church cannot and should not normalize homosexuality and homosex as such. When we converse with one another on this topic, we need to be faithful. And as Nico said this morning, that we should do this in a adult and responsible way, but we need to be faithful as well. We need to be faithful to the mission of the church to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to all the world. We cannot declare or proclaim another gospel. And if the gospel that I proclaim to you this morning differs from what you believe it to be, then you can stand up and argue with me. No problem there. But we need to be faithful to the mission of the church to proclaim the gospel. Faithfulness also means faithfulness to Scripture. That is the Bible. That is the Word of God. In everything that I said, I need to be faithful to the Bible and you yourself as well when we talk in theological terms concerning this topic. Being faithful in our discourse requires a faithful conversation with a history and Christian tradition. What we are talking about this morning it's not just what we grab together, that we put together, that we scrape together. There's a tradition of the church of 2,000 years that we have to take into consideration as well. And faithful conversation means being faithful in engaging one another in dialogue that will do justice to the seriousness of this issue under discussion. So there will not be any jokes concerning sexuality this morning. This is a serious discussion. It's concerning people. It's concerning the orientation, concerning lifestyle of people. So we need to grasp the seriousness of this conversation. I'm going to play you something again. In this first session, when we talk this morning, I'm going to give you a socio-historical background concerning homosexuality. We need to understand that the Bible itself did not originate in a vacuum. It came into being within a specific situation, and homosexuality, homosexual conduct has been with us since 3000 BC. 3,000 years before Christ. That's when we found where we find the first inscription concerning homosexuality. So I'm going to give you a background. I want you to see and I want you to understand when we come to the Old Testament and the New Testament that the pronunciations that's made in the Bible have a sort of a back setting. It comes from somewhere. It is a saying, it's something that's been written in response to a situation, not just in a vacuum. So what we're going to do now when we look at the people of that time, at the Mesopotamians, and we look at the Egyptians, then that's to create for you an understanding of what was going on And when the Bible itself was brought into being, that you can understand what was said. Cult prostitution involving heterosexual and homosexual acts was found early, nearly everywhere, and at all times in the ancient Near East. So, sexual acts was part and parcel from human beings' existence right from the beginning. So we find descriptions of it, we find writings of it, just about from the earliest time that writing was done. Throughout the ancient Near East, from early times, anal intercourse formed a part of goddess worship. We see that in the cults, the religions of that time, that this particular type of sexual conduct was part and parcel of the goddess worship in that time. Male and female prostitutes had intercourse with male worshippers in sanctuaries and shrines in Mesopotamia, Phoenicia, Cyprus, Corinth, Carthage, Sicily, Libya, and West Africa. So this is something that was found throughout time and with all people. They served these male and female prostitutes, served temporarily or permanently, and they performed all types of sexual acts. There's enough in the literature and in the history that one could ascertain that all types of sexual acts was formed or were practiced at that time. One particular type of homosexuality that existed in ancient times, and we'll see it especially with the Greeks and with the Romans, was the love for a beautiful boy. A male, adult male, would take a boy, and under certain circumstances, this homosexual relationship would then flourish. And this is a well-known fact and well-described in literature. Then kings of that time also had male lovers along with their wives. Warriors developed romantic attachments. Ordinary men had anal intercourse with male and female cultic personnel. So it is a broad spectrum of sexuality that was practiced in those times. But we're going to focus in these lectures specifically then on homosexual conduct, because that is the question that we need to look at. To understand it. Let's go to Mesopotamia. Mesopotamia, there where Babylon is situated, 3000 BC, 3000 before Christ, is the first recorded evidence of homosexuality in Mesopotamia. And we have there a picture. I'll show it to you a little bit better in the next slide. But it's the best known example that we have. It comes from a silver plate that appears from the old Babylonian period. It was found in various cities, the same plate. The cities are mentioned for you there: Uruk, Assur, Babylon, and Susa. It's an act of sodomy. It means that one man is having sex with another man while the one is bent over. And that is the picture that we have of this act, and there it is. That's the portion that was found, and one can then be seen. Now, sources from Mesopotamia testify to the existence of male cult figures whose sexuality was confused or liminal and who engaged in various sex-related practices. When we say that, it simply means that male cult prostitutes or male cult figures, we will name them a little bit later, they engaged in homosexual acts. One text that we have refers to the Sinishanu, which is the literal meaning of this word is a man who is woman-like. There is a portion that describes this Sinishanu going to a tavern, what we would call today a bar, would go there and agree to divide his earnings with a bartender or with this tavern owner. And tavern seems to be the place where these people would be picked up, or where this kind of sex would be found, or prostitutes would be found to have this kind of sex with them. Then the Asinu, he was a cultic priest of Ishtar's cultic staff. Ishtar, you read from in the Bible many times. It was a goddess that was worshipped in Babylonia and in Canaan. It was a man, it seems a man might have intercourse whose masculinity had become femininity. In other words, this kind of person would change his appearance from a man to a woman, in the sense that he would have longer hair or dress up like that or whatever the case might be. But it was a cultic member. It was a staff member of Ishtar's cultic staff in the temple. Then you have the effeminate Kulu, which is also a different kind of person when we talk about the cultic staff. A real man, and I use the word real here in the sense of describing the normal man that we would call the heterosexual man, the father, the one that is in the family, was called a Zikaru. Now, the Kulu and the Kurgaru, which is mentioned, they sang and acted and danced in worship of Inanna or Ishtar, as she was mentioned, the cultic staff. So it's just to make clear from this portion that there were certain kind of cultic staff or men that presented themselves in a specific manner, and that sexual conduct and very much then homosex was in the order of the day that they practiced at these places. Now, Nissenin is a man that also wrote a book concerning this whole issue of homosex. And this is perhaps important because in the Bible we have two or three references that we can trace back to this situation. He pointed out that the cuneiform signs, we've got it in we call it in Afrikaans spykerskrift or stick writing in English. The word that is used for Asinu were the words Ursal, which means dog woman. Very particular for this kind of person. But as far as we can ascertain, it perhaps refers back to the way that they practiced sex, the homosex, the men, where the one man would bend forward and the other one would be behind him. That they related this to the way that animals do it. And that's because they used the word ursal, which means dog woman. That's a reference that they got from Mesopotamia. But it has relevance for us when we come to Deuteronomy, where it talks about the rewards of a dog. Or in Revelation as well, there are certain references to these words. There are two laws in Mesopotamia that mention sex between men. And I've got one law here for you, Law 20, which considers homosexual acts between male equals. It means males of the equal social status. If a man has sex with his comrade, and this is proven, then his accusers shall have sex with him and turn him into a eunuch. In other words, if a man is found to have sexual relationships with his equal, with somebody on the same social status with him, then he will be accused. They will have to gang rape him. And then after that, he is to be castrated. That is his punishment because of having sex with your equal. We will see a little bit later that homosex was reserved for unequals, but we will come to that. To seduce a male equal into passive intercourse was the crime, severely punished by gang rape and castration. For a man to turn himself into the recipient of the sexual act, to turn himself into the penetrated, was a crime. It was a giving up of your manliness, of what they regarded to be a man. So these two laws, Law 20 and Laws 19 and 20, then suggest that for a male to take up the submissive role, it was a crime. Anal intercourse was freely pictured then in figurative art in the ancient cities of Uruk, Assur, Babylon, and Susa from the 3rd millennium BC onward. There are many, many images I've shown you in the one image. Now, two kings that is connected to homosexual relationships is both Zimri-Lin, the king of Mari, and Hammurabi, the king of Babylon. Hammurabi, we have many laws of him. The Code of Hammurabi is something which is very well known. They had male lovers. They were both married, but they also had male lovers. The queen of Zimri-Lin wrote a letter and mentions matter-of-factly in this letter that the king had sexual relations, or these two kings had sexual relations with men as well. Then we find from that time the Summa Alu. The Summa Alu is a manual used to predict the future. But in this manual, there are five instances where homosexual acts or sexual acts are mentioned, or where homosex is mentioned. If you practice one of these five instances, the homosex, then certain things will happen to you. In the first instance, it says, if a man copulates with his equal from the rear, he becomes the leader among his peers and his brothers. This is a very important point. Remember it, because we're going to find this back in the Bible somewhere as well. And then you have to relate back to what this historical, socio-historical background is telling you. But if in a city, a man have homosex with his master, or with the leader, he reduces that leader to a submissive role, and he becomes the new leader because he succeeded in doing that. If a man yearns to express his manhood while in prison, and thus, like a male cult prostitute, mating with men becomes his desire, he will experience evil. If a man copulates with an asinu, that's a male cult prostitute, trouble will leave him. So here we have an instance where we say that where homosex is practiced under the auspices of the cult, then it brings good luck to you. If a man copulates with a gerseku, that's a male courtier or a royal attendant from the royal court, he will be possessed by worry for 1 year, and then that will leave him. And if a man copulates with a houseborn slave, a hard destiny will befall him. So that is then comes from the Summa Alu, this book that took the future and said that if you practice these kinds of homosexual relationships, certain things is going to happen in your life. So when we summarize this, we can say that to penetrate a male who was of equal status or a cult prostitute was thought to bring good fortune. That could be well for you to do that. But with a royal attendant, a fellow prisoner, or a household slave, that would bring, obviously, trouble into your life. There are some pictures of Ishtar or Inanna, the same goddess, just in certain circumstances they are mentioned differently. And they had many male cult prostitutes in their shrines which practiced homosex. What was the argument? What was the argument when it came to these shrines? What was the argument that male sexual acts was a good thing? Well, simply put, when a man ejaculated his semen into another man's anus at the shrine, he was depositing more male power. That was the argument in the literature. And with the additional strength of many men, then the God was pleased and he would give more blessings. So that was the argument, and that's why homosex was practiced at all of these shrines. Then we have the story, the epic of Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh, a hero, a very strong man, and he was a god. He did not respect male or female in his exploits. And then the gods made him Enkidu, which is a man, to stem him or to satisfy his sexual needs. And this whole story is about the relationship between Gilgamesh and Enkidu. So that is then also related in the story. Now this is concerning Mesopotamia. That's the ways that homosexual conduct took place in the history of Mesopotamia. When we come to Egypt, we have some views there as well. Egypt, which is of a little bit later, but also then in a parallel time slot than Mesopotamia. Ancient Egypt was a civilization of vast diversity. When we talk about sexual conduct, when we talk about sexuality, many different sexual behaviors took place. We find homosexuality, transgenderism, incest marriages, exhibitionism, prostitution, adultery, bestiality, necrophilia, that is sex with corpses. All of that is related in the history and in the books that we find and in the literature of ancient Egypt. Ancient Egypt, within their religion, sexuality was vast and it was practiced. For example, the goddess Siris had sexual relationships with his sister, the goddess Isis, and she conceived the god Horus, the one with the head of an eagle. Now, why I'm saying this is that you try to understand that the way that we think about sex is not the way that they thought about sex. They would allow many more things that we would perhaps allow today as well. But in Egypt, all kinds of sexual relationships were practiced. The Egyptians believed in sex in the afterlife. For example, sex was not taboo. Even the Egyptian religion was filled with tales, that the religion of their gods were filled of tales of adultery, incest, homosexuality, and masturbation, and then the hints of necrophilia for the gods. And on the right, we have a picture of the Nile god, which is a male-female picture of the god. It's a combination figure that we have there. Writing in Egypt, in the top, we have the writing for a male. You will see the sexual organ there with a man on his knees. And the second one, the one for woman, that was the writing that is used. And then at the bottom, there is the male without the sexual organs, which then depicts the homosexual person in the writings of Egypt. There's a tomb in Egypt for two homosexual people. It is the tomb of Nyankamum and Kanumhotep. They were manicurists and hairdressers. And that is just a picture drawn from the murals that we have there. So there's a specific tomb that was dedicated and where the bodies of the mummies of these two men is lying. Nefertiti, the beautiful one, is just a queen of that time. But on the right-hand side, we again have a picture of the two men walking, holding hands. So we find in Egypt that homosexual conduct was not a foreign thing. There's even a tomb, there are murals, there are many more pictures, I've not shown you all, of these two men and the way that they conducted themselves. When we come to the Hittites, we find that that's the way that they wrote in picture language, we find there's only one reference within the Hittites. It says, if a man violates his son, it is a capital crime. It talks about homosexual conduct or homosex between a father and his son that was not allowed. This judgment, says the Hittitologist Harry Hoffner, says that it's not because he sodomized his son that it's the crime, but he's guilty of urkel, that's illegal intercourse. Because the partner is his son, not because they are the same sex. So the deduction here is that homosex per se was not wrong with the Hittites, but urkel or illegitimate sex is wrong because it's a father with his son. The same sort of law we get for daughters and their mothers as well. When we come to the Canaanites, then we find that there are many references in the Bible. Here on the left you have Baal, and then you have Ishtar, and then you've got a fertility god there, pictures of. Exodus 34, which says, but you shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves, for thou shalt worship no other god, for the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous god. And thou take of their daughters unto thy sons, and their daughters go on warring after their gods, and make thy sons go on a warring after their gods. So there's a definite picture here that the gods of the Canaanites and the gods of God's people, or the God of God's people, are different and that their conduct is different. So Tom Horner wrote that the Philistines, for example, had a culture which accepted homosexuality and so probably influenced Israel in this respect in the writings of the Bible. One of the early gods of the Assyrians, which later spread into the area known as Canaan, was Asherah. Now we have references of Asherah as well in the Bible, in Ezekiel, and in the smaller prophets. There are references to this goddess. She was worshipped as the goddess of fertility, and these worshipping services many times included orgies and sexual practices. Philo of Alexandria, in his writing on the life of Abram, wrote of the land of the Sodomites, a reference perhaps to Sodom and Gomorrah, but also a reference that holds true for the way that they practice sex from time to time. And he said that it was brimful of innumerable iniquities. The word iniquity, we refer back when speaking to Sodomites or Sodom and Gomorrah, we refer back to the sexual practice that took place there. The Bible then, when we have references concerning the sexual practices of Canaan, then the Lord said, because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great and because their sin is very grievous, there we have a reference. And then the men of the city, the men of Sodom, we will come to that when we talk about the Old Testament. They wanted to have sex with the young men at Lot's house. Again, a reference there to sexual practices, referring to homosexual practices. Then we have a Midrash, the Vayikra Rava. It is a discussion on biblical portions. And in chapter 23 of this Midrash, or this discussion, it explains that the Egyptians were steeped in sexual immorality and the land of Canaan was replete with immorality and witchcraft. References that gives us an indication of what kind of sexual practices was practiced there. Then again, just the reason why it was practiced in Canaan as well. And then the second point, it was very early in the human history that both male and female prostitutes were used in temple worship in order to raise funds for the temple as well as support themselves. So that is then the situation there. We come to Greece, and you can listen a bit. Thank you. Now remember that I'm busy creating a picture for you. We are not forming any judgments here. We leave that until we come to the Old Testament and the New Testament. I'm creating a picture for you, trying to show you that in those times, sexual conduct included all types of sex. Male, when we talk about male and female, or then gay and lesbian sex, I've shown you pictures of males. It's a man with a boy with a boy, a man with a man, a boy with a man. All kinds of homosex took place in those times. One of the more explicit examples of a known person of that time is Alexander the Great. We have had a film not too long ago also on his life. But it's a famous example. He was married. He had wives, but he also had a male lover, Hephaestion, which was one of his generals, and also a nobleman and a very close friend and a lover of the king Alexander the Great. There are two pictures of them. On the left, Alexander the Great, and to the right, then Hephaestion, just that you can see what they sort of looked like. That is not very good, but those are remnants of statues that they have. There were two city-states in Greece, Athens and Sparta. And the type of homosex that was practiced in these cities differed. In the city-state of Athens, the gay pattern of sexuality involved intergenerational sponsoring or mentoring. An older man, perhaps a teacher or a philosopher, would take a younger man, a young adult, into his house. He will be teaching him concerning life and philosophy and whatever, but at the same time, they would then have sex as well, homosex. But mostly, in the literature, it had to do with mutual masturbation. It is not so much the anal sex that was practiced. That was in Athens. But in Sparta, the other city-state, it was not so. Boys were actually raised in military barracks, acting as orderly housekeepers, waiters, and sexual companions of the adult officers. And they would stay that until they started growing their beard. Then they would again find themselves a younger man. But that was, although that was the norm, that was not the only way in which it was done. But anal as well as oral sex between same-sex partners were not something that was strange in the city-state of Sparta. Lesbos was an island, the Isle of Lesbos, where the poetess Sappho had a school for girls and for young women. And that is known to be a lesbian situation, a lesbian school where they practiced lesbian sex. Men were not allowed on the Isle of Lesbos. The gods of the Greeks were again known for various sexual patterns. Bisexuality was practiced. For example, Apollo, he would love both young men and young women. And then Greeks also had their god Zeus. He was married to Hera. But Zeus, we have seen a picture of him with the young man Ganymede. And there's in the literature ample writings on the sexual exploits of Zeus, which included homosex as well. One of the arguments today is that the Bible did not know about long-term, loving, caring, homosexual relationships. That is foreign to Paul, it's foreign to the Bible, it's a sexual lifestyle today, if I may use that word, that is unknown to the biblical times. But I hear seven or eight homosexual relationships, which is mentioned in the Greek text, between men that was sometimes lifelong. We have the story of Orestes and Pylades, Damon and Pythias, and then some others as well. Just to show that there are ample examples in the socio-historical history, in the history of mankind, where there were such loving, caring relationships. and it's mentioned sometimes with great positiveness, these relationships, and there are some more that is mentioned. When we come to Rome, we come now more to the contemporary time of the New Testament, the time in which Paul and the apostles lived, the time in which the Lord Jesus lived, and what perhaps, if we take everything that I've said now as background, and we come now to the time that they lived, and we ask ourselves, but the Greek time, the Hellenistic time, and the Roman time, what was the situation then that influenced the New Testament? Now, within Rome, there were handsome men servants known as concubini, which served their masters sexually in bed until they matured or they fell into disfavor. A Roman man was known as a vir, or the plural viri. They were not allowed to have pedicare, that's anal sex, with other Roman men. Again, we get the idea here of having sex with a man or a partner on the same sexual level or the same social level. That was not allowed, unless, of course, they were slaves. Very real Roman men choose pedicare with slaves quite often. It's attested to in the writings and the literature many times. So for the Roman men, it was not who you did it with, but how it was done. The real man would be the one on top, and the slave would be the one receiving the receiving side, or he was the one that was the receptor of the penetration in the sexual act. Seneca, the philosopher, wrote, "A man in the bedroom, a boy in the dining room." This is a saying that was written in that time, and it meant simply the following. Seneca is saying that the slave is submissive to his master at all times outside of the bedroom. In other words, if sex was practiced in public or in a public space, not in the enclosed space of the bedroom, then the Roman man would be the penetrator. But when it goes into the bedroom, the tables would be turned, and then the Roman man, the vir, would become the penetrated one in the situation. Then Suetonius, he was a historian, he wrote the history and of the Romans, quite a few books on that. And he wrote of a time when Julius Caesar had submitted himself to King Nicomedes of Bithynia. Caesar had been called such things as the Queen of Bithynia, and Octavius referred to Caesar as a queen, just as Pompey was a king. So we will come now to the point where we will show that in the Roman era, when we come to the last 12 Roman Caesars, you will see that 11 of them were homosexual or bisexual in their sexual conduct. A few pictures from Pompeii. There's a picture from a Pompeii brothel that was found in a Pompeii brothel of men having sex. There are some other examples, homosex here. There, a male and a female, and then bestiality, a male with a goat. There's a mural that was found, a man with a boy as well as with a sex toy, bestiality. So Suetonius wrote a book on the lives of the first 12 Caesars, and his works is generally considered to be historically impartial. He told things as they were, and it is accepted for what he said. Tiberius was Caesar up to AD 37. Now, AD 37 means that it's 37 after Christ, and the Lord Jesus started his work when he was 30 years old, more or less AD 26 to AD 34, in that time. So what I'm showing you now, you must remember, are the Caesars of the time that Jesus and the apostles lived and they wrote their writings. This Caesar Tiberius, he took babies from their mothers and weaned them from their mother's breast to suck on his chest and on his groin. And he had young men and women brought to him and trained in sexual practices. So he was very debased in his sexual preferences. Caligula, he is known as a sexual immoral person. He didn't regard or had respect for his own chastity, nor that of anyone else. He had relationships with men. Catullus, a young man, is well known that he had sexual relationships with. And this young man said that he spent nights with the Caesar when he really worn the Caesar out. So there are some writings on that. Claudius was a person who was handicapped, but he mostly had relationships with women, and he was married 4 times. Then we have Nero, also a person that was very, very sexually immoral. He abused boys, freeborn boys, it means Roman boys. He did not respect the Roman citizenship. He castrated the boy Sporus. He married him in a ceremony with a veil and everything, and a dowry and a bridal veil. He took him as his queen wherever he went. He introduced Sporus as his queen. He treated him as his wife. And the same Nero was the one that was the Caesar when Paul lived, and Paul was martyred. And then just another something there about Nero and Sporus as well. And then Julius Caesar, he had affairs when he was 20 years old with King Nicomedes of Bithynia. He was called every man's wife and every woman's husband. He had a reputation for vice and a reputation for homosexuality, Julius Caesar. So this gives us background towards the situation in which the New Testament then came into being. Then there are some books, the Apocrypha and the Sealed Epigrapha. Those books were written in the intertestamental time between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And there again, we can glean some information from these books. Some of these books are accepted by the Roman Catholic Church as authoritative, but we in the Protestant tradition don't accept them to be canonic for us, as we accept the Old Testament and the New Testament. But these scriptures can tell us something about the history, and sometimes they interpret then also the Old Testament. And obviously what has been said in that influenced the Old Testament and New Testament as well. So we have sometimes quotations from these books in the Old and New Testament, and we find some then in Jude, for example. There's the book of Ecclesiasticus, the wisdom of Yeshua, the son of Sirach, and I've highlighted in red what is regarded today as references to sexual practices. And he's referring to Lot and the people among whom Lot was living. He said, whom he detested, that is God, for their pride. Pride here equals sexual arrogance. We find this not just from the words written here, but also from Midrash discussions, and also from what the rabbis said and how they interpreted these portions. Then we have the wisdom of Solomon. And he speaks there of the confusion of sex. And then Genesios analage, the Greek words that I've tried to transliterate there so that you can read it. But he speaks of the confusion of sex. Winston translated the change of sex, confusion of sex, the interchange of sex roles, this Greek words that is being used there. Then we have the Sealed Epigrapha, or the false writings that is not accepted in this church tradition as authoritative. Most of the books are named after Old Testament people, but these books we can just have a look at as well. We sometimes have references to Enoch. There we have 2 Enoch, Enoch chapter 10, verse 4, which speaks about which is against nature, which is child corruption in the anus in the manner of Sodom, referring to homosexual acts in Sodom and describing it there. And then in chapter 34, verse 2, there's a reference, friend with friend, the anus and every other kind of wicked uncleanness, which is too disgusting to report, and the worship of the evil. Then we have Maccabees. 3 Maccabees has a chapter 2, verse 5 has a reference. Sodom acted insolently and became notorious for their crimes. Insolently here is regarded as reference to the sexual practices there. Again, Jubilees. All their works, that they are wicked and sinners exceedingly, and that they defile themselves and commit fornication in their flesh. Here the sin of Sodom is definitely considered sexual. Comes from the commentaries. Then there are 12 books being written for the 12 sons of Jacob. And it's called the Testament, and then of one of the sons. The Testament of Naphtali, chapter 3, verse 4 to 5, speak about which changed the order of nature with reference to Sodom. The Testament of Benjamin, I tell you, will be sexually promiscuous like the promiscuity of the Sodomites. You shall commit fornication with the fornication of Sodom. And references there to the sexual deeds. So, within this first session now, I've tried to give you background information. Just that you can have in a nutshell some background of information that when we talk about the Old Testament and when we talk about the New Testament, that in the back of your mind, you will be able to see, to place the Old and New Testament within the socio-historical concept, context when we speak about sexuality and what, especially homosexuality, and what was done in that time. So keep this now in mind. We have now then given you some background information.